welcome to the 19th Sunday of Pentecost here at Emanuel Lutheran. Just a few announcements this morning for those who did not realize we did start Sunday school this morning at 9:45. And judging by attendance, I see it's over. Maybe, I hope. Of course, the old story reminded of a joke Pastor Tom had told me. We have mice in the church. You're not sure how to get rid of them for a Sunday school and invite them. But again, that'll be next Sunday as well at 9:45 a.m. to just about 10:15. So if you get a chance, please do stop that. The story time of John, the lunchtime study program, where we are reviewing the book, the story, which is a continual novel telling of the entire Bible. That starts this Tuesday at 12 noon. We'll meet over in the overflow. Bring back lunch. Usually we take about an hour, so if you want to spend lunch time with us, again, that's noon. If you need a book, because we are reviewing your book, if you need a book, please let me know. I do have extra copies available for that. In the back of the church, you'll see an orange flyer that looks a lot like the one that I have in my hand, and that is for the ladies' night out, which will be on October 22nd. Now, let me explain what a spider party is, because I don't want people to think we're celebrating Halloween. Kind of, but again, there are different prizes and stuff that are attached by yarn. Those are weaved around to look like a spider web, and then you can bid on them and chase down your little wire. It's just a good night, a good thing to do for the ladies, give them a little bit of fellowship time here at the church. And of course, for those secret sisters out there, and I don't know who they were, but thank you for the card. My wife's and my anniversary, so I see that is still working. Please continue the great work that you are doing. Of course, being October, Reformation Day is coming up at us really fast. That'll be on the 31st, so I'm giving you a heads up. It's Red Day on the 31st. I'm wearing red, and of course, we'll be celebrating Reformation here. I'd like to do a potluck lunch after that, so that folks can kind of get an idea of what we're doing. Talk to Pam, but I don't see her here today, so we'll continue working on that, and more will come as we go ahead. Also, for those who don't realize, the newsletter has gone out via email and is also in the back of the church. Please pick up your copy of that and take it with you. Again, if there's any questions on anything that's in the newsletter, make sure you let Donna in the office know, or give me a holler, and I will be glad to explain. Are there any other announcements or anything that I have not covered? No. Well, welcome to worship, and let us prepare.
Thank you.
Let us begin. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates us and forms us, who redeems us and calls us, who unites us and sends us. Amen.
Amen.
Gathered in God's presence, let us confess our sin. Mighty and loving God,
we confess we are captive in sin and cannot free ourselves. We seek our own way. We divide the body of Christ. In your mercy, cleanse us and heal us. Let the word of our mouths, the thought of our hearts, and everything that we do be filled with faith, hope, and love. Amen.
Hear the voice of Jesus. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me to proclaim release to the captives. In the name of Jesus Christ, I proclaim to you that your sins are forgiven and you are released. The joy of the Lord is your strength, and the gifts of the Holy Spirit are yours forever.
Amen. Amen.
Our opening hymn is God is Here, number 526.
Thank you.
the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And also with you.
Taken from the man, made into a woman, and brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this one was taken. Therefore a man leaves his father and his mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh." Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
Let us sing the song. Amen.
Hallelujah, Lord, and Savior, oh.
Lord with you.
And also with you.
A reading of the Holy Gospel according to Mark, the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Some Pharisees came, and to test Jesus, they asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife?" He answered them, "What did Moses command you?" They said, "Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her." But Jesus said to them, "Because of your hardness of heart, he wrote this commandment for you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and a mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh, so that they no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about this matter. He said to them, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them, and the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant, and he said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them. For it is such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And then he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
So good to see you, Sven. Isn't he gotten taller? I might have to get a bench that's longer away. Can I sit between you two? Am I allowed?
Yeah, make tons of space as well.
Yeah,
this is a full gospel preacher.
Anyway, okay, so listening to the lessons today, what did you hear that seemed to be the repeating thing? This is really important because this is like you guys' day to day. Okay, if you don't know right away. Talks a lot about the children today. Wasn't there a lot of children stuff and how we should honor and take care of them? Now, you were children. Now, in the time of the gospel, you know, children were, you know, they didn't have any rights at all. In fact, even the girls didn't go to school. Why do you think Jesus said it was really important that to get into the kingdom of heaven, you have to be like a little child, though, if they didn't have rights or they didn't have power of any kind? Why do you think that might be? Any answer about that? No? Okay. Well, I'm going to explain a little bit. Okay. It is our responsibilities, all of us as adults, that we are to teach our children. So we should be going over the word, and that because you guys receive it at most, sometimes as even first hearing, that it's kind of new to you, right? I know when I preach and stuff, sometimes even I see stuff that's new to me, even after all these years of you know, going to church and hearing it. But it's important for you guys. What do you think your responsibility is? If it's our job to teach you, it must be your job to learn. That's right. But there's also one more little part that goes with that. And that little part is that you cannot be afraid to ask questions. We do a lot of things up here, don't we? You know, David here in a little while is going to do the blessed, you know, to prepare for communion and the distribution of communion. Have you ever questioned wondering what goes on up here? No, but you've been pretty involved in the church, and so have you. So you kind of get an unusual view, but a lot of kids don't do that. So if anybody ever asked you, you know, hey, you know, what goes on in church, and you know, give an answer for what?
We worship God.
Yeah, we worship God, that's right.
And that's a simple and very easy answer. Yes?
Why don't we pray?
Heavenly Father, as a group, let us bring the word to one such as these. Let us live the example of that word in our lives so that they too can grow up in a faith and a strength in you. And as always, we ask everything in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Go ahead and have a seat, guys. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
As an organist, I learned kind of quickly that the instrument was magical. It was a marvel to be seen and heard, well, at least in the eyes of children. They would look up front, I would notice, sitting there, and they'd look up with wonder, where did all that sound come from? The sound comes out of here, but he's sitting over there, so behind a screen out of their sight. Pay no mind to the guy behind the curtain, like they used to say in the old magic shows. They knew that I sat there, but something happened, and magically seems that music came out. Now, in this church, there's always been an open invitation for the children to come up to the organ pit to see exactly what happened. And that's open to both young and old. Our 1927 Bowler pipe organ is a marvel. Even now. But many times parents will pull children back. Don't touch. Don't bother him or her. They don't have time for you and your silliness. You'll break it. The children's curiosity is appreciated because you see many years ago, I see myself and them. I needed to know what happened there. And I know somehow if Mr. Greeley hadn't been let me to be curious and ask questions about the organ, I'm not sure I'd be standing up here today. Here at Emanuel. When reading Mark, it's wise to be reminded his use of simile and allegory. It's extremely far-reaching. The shortest gospel, and perhaps the first one, compiled around 70 or so Common Era. This time is important as Mark's audience, a very Jewish one, would have been witnesses to the destruction of the Second Temple, to persecution and execution by the Roman Empire under Nero, and the scattering of the nation again. These messianic Jews, those who believed in Christ as Savior, knowing that Jesus is Messiah, who died and rose again and will come again in glory and majesty, that he was willing to die for them, listen to the telling and the stories about God becoming man, a man from Galilee, with hope, with faith, and love. Mark's Jesus is in constant tension. If you read it from beginning to end, as some scholars recommend, instead of in pieces, you would see Jesus as the suffering servant, a sacrifice for us all. In the telling of the miracles in Mark, if you look closely, you'll always see a death or condition resembling it, leading to death or constant sorrow, demonic possession for one. Yet Jesus performs the miracle. He says and does the same thing. Rise up. Rise up. Pick up your cot. Talitha kum. Little one, rise up. Through Mark and the tensions that Jesus encounters, he is telling us the resurrection story over and over and over. Conflict, then suffering, then recovery. From the words, the kingdom is near, down to see the place where he was laid. Mark is reminding us that Jesus is that answer, no matter the conflict. Add God to that mix, and even though you may have conflict, and through the conflict, you may suffer. Through grace given by God, building up our faith through the Spirit, you will rise again, whole, fulfilled, righteous, and complete. Today we hear Jesus, the true man, answering the Pharisees' trap question concerning divorce.
Yes, Moses gave the divorce to stop her grumbling through a letter of dismissal, yet they failed to see Jesus, the true God, responding to the question as well. In the denying nature of Christ, do we see his answer reflect the relationship that we have between the Father and us? The church being God's bride? As we heard in Isaiah a few weeks back, God did not dismiss our mother. He didn't divorce us. We divorced him. And likewise, in today's gospel, God made us. He loves us. We, humankind, the great bride, went out and divorced God. God brings us to him and even provided atonement through the sacrifice of his Son for the sin that we, humankind, committed. And yet, sometimes it just doesn't seem like enough. Bread and quail in the desert, water from a rock. Jesus, the new Moses, feeding the 5,000, and through the Last Supper provides a perfect sacrifice, that perfect meal, exactly what we need. Jesus leading God's people home like Moses in the desert. And yet, sometimes it's still not enough. We found the world more appealing. The Pharisees, in the divine analogy, representing the hierarchy, Nero, the Romans, trying to scatter and destroy God's people, to destroy that messianic secret of Christ, to remove God from everything that we knew and believed, to make us fear them more than God. Well, that plan attacked. As God joined us as one family, as his great bride, not even the mightiest empires of the world could put God's love and promise. They could not put us asunder. And of course, Jesus goes through all this, but the disciples need another explanation. The disciples ask Jesus in private to explain this. And using the analogy of God as the groom and us the bride, if we do divorce God in our lives and find another, if we let opposition of the faith, the established, misled leaders, the Roman government, the medieval church, you know, remember Luther? The gods of money, power, position, fame. We let all that take over. Doesn't that represent, idolatry? Not only in their time, but we have that problem in our time as well. Because we are his children, when children are sent away, Jesus is upset with the disciples. Were they too acting as superiors to the children, being worth more of Jesus' time and love than these children? Treating those who were just above dogs in the hierarchical society. They were below a servant. Having no power, no say, no worth to speak of. But Jesus' disciples also lord over his people. Na 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 na, we are disciples and you are not. Didn't think I'd go there, did you? Didn't Jesus address them about the greatest and the least? And yet here they were treating the least as less than even that. Jesus, the man, just explained the Pharisees, the hows and whys of divorce, and yet those closest to him, those supposedly that knew him, acted just like those Jesus condemned for their actions. We recently heard in Mark, yes, it is like that with them, the temple folks over there, but not for you. Jesus, true God, had one more thing to say about the kingdom today. And this lesson, much like the first one, we need to look at the world behind the text to see more of his message. God's message of hope, not only in the first century church, but all the way down to us today. Mr. Greeley let me see and explore the organ of the church. He opened my mind and my eyes to many worlds and possibilities, but none greater than to a service, a life of service to God and to church. He was a church organist and a servant first. If through his example, by showing that to me, here at the organ, or as a lay leader now, or maybe in one day a pastor, one day one in the future, to lead others to follow Jesus in a life of servitude, in a life helping others, I say, well, come on, let's do it. If they want to see the table, the children, they want to see the table or this pulpit or the sacristy, or learn about why we do one thing or another, I still say, come forward, rise up, look and see. Because all are welcome. By sharing our lives and joy with others, we too can share Christ's love in our lives and the grace given by our God. After the destruction of the temple, Mark's audience would need reassurance, like we do from time to time, that they are the church. Take away the temple, and Jesus is still Lord of all. And the church goes on. But leaders, fellow Christians, do not forget the downtrodden, the weak, those most like the children in our lives and in our communities. Bring them to God and teach them all. Them to continue to spread the word, not only in the world now, because our children are our future, and they need to teach it then. Do not discount the least of us, for they are as servants, slaves, children, the least in the kingdom. The rest, that's dictated to us by Christ, part of our baptismal vocation, as part of the priesthood of all believers. And Jesus, he took them up in his arms. He laid hands on them, and we blessed them. Do we at times see people in our life like that? A visitor unknown to us, a face, a new face walking through the doors. Maybe their clothes aren't the best. Maybe they need a shower. They look hungry. Desperate, alone. We are, by the example shown in the gospel today, to embrace, protect, and advocate for all those children, no matter what age they are, and those who cannot do for themselves. White man, you walk into town. You see him there? Do we approach or avoid? Let your world depart. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. God has counted on his bride, his people, to bring the least to him, to teach and embrace, and to bless and fortify all God's children. He's gathering us to him. Let no one, let nothing step in the way and separate what God has joined together with him. Amen.
Amen.
Let us join together as one church, one family, as we say together in one voice the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He descended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Made children heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Holy One, you have raised up faithful leaders throughout history. Empower those discerning the call to ministry and all Sumerians. John Kearns, as they continue to be formed for the sake of the gospel, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You've established diverse and beautiful creation, revive declining species, preserve endangered lands, cultivate in us a sense of wonder for the world you created. Glory in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You desire for us not to be alone and to live in community with one another. Strengthen relationships between nations and peoples that we celebrate and support one human family. Glory in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You share in our experiences and struggles. Bless all who live with any mental or physical disabilities. We pray especially for Paul Anderson, Gigi Carroll, Mary Delaney, Patricia Walt, Betty Bradley, Doris Vinka, Denise Stoffit, Debbie Scher, Larry Shine, Holly Bernardi, Todd Erickson, Cindy Soley, Gregory Buckner, Lois Schultz, Joyce Maxwell, Marlene Kiowski, Steve Cavallaro, Robbie Swinton, Rick Grandetti, Nancy Gordon, Joanne Ferguson, Bishop Lozano, Andy and Pam Boyd, family and friends of Jane Luciano, and anyone we name.
Mary Lou, that lady, Sherry Sterner, her husband Dave, Rick Fisher, John Wickett, me.
Inspire creative communities, spaces, and environments that are accessible and hospitable. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You have established and nurtured relationships that extend beyond those gathered here today. Bless members who can no longer travel to worship with us. And remind us of your continued role in this community of faith. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You promised eternal life to all your children. Thank you for the people of faith who have gone before us. Strengthen our trust we have in you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with all of you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you. Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. When our congregation gathered for the celebration of Holy Communion, we're to begin the story of God's mighty acts and the love shown us in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. With thanksgiving, remember that in the night in which he betrayed, he took the bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to all the drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We are given assurance of our Lord's presence through the gift of his Holy Spirit. Now we bring to you this same bread of life and this same cup of blessing, that you may be strengthened through your participation in the body of Christ. Lord, remember your kingdom. Teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thy is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Christ shed for you.
The blood of Christ.
shed for you.
Amen.
The blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ broken for you.
Amen.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Our closing hymn is number 796, How Firm a Foundation.